of two talks, so Uwe Schmuck and Georges Jubelli. So we start with Uwe, who is going to talk about normal variance mixture distribution as an approximation of Poisson mixture sums.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction, and thank you to the organizers, in particular to Georges Jubelli, for putting together such a nice conference, and also the workshop over the weekend, which I really enjoyed, so thanks. And in particular, thanks for inviting me to come to Rio. So today I have the opportunity to report on joint work with Peter Eichelsbacher, a co-author of mine, and a former PhD student, Pete Porkert. And the talk will be more on mathematics and finance and not so much on options. I apologize for that. I hope it's okay. So here's an outline of my talk. So I will spend some time on introducing the model and the problem and what can be done there. Then I will introduce the prerequisites for the theorem. And finally, I will state the theorem and maybe give an idea of the proof if time permits. Okay, let's start and let's recall the collective model from actuarial science. So we start with, a sequence of IID claims, and we assume they are independent of the total number of claims capital N. And for the insurance company, it's important to know the total claim amount. So that's the sum of the individual claims where the number of terms is random, given by capital N. Of course, you can also give it a credit risk interpretation. So you say you have a random number of defaults and xn is what you lose due to the defaults. And so that's a total loss in your credit risk portfolio. Or more applied to finance, you can say, well, xn is a price change or a logarithmic price change of an asset, and capital N is the number of price changes you observe within a certain time period. So with high-frequency trading, there can be a lot of price changes, and then it's reasonable to ask, well, what's the net effect of all these price changes? So what kind of models should you use for price changes? And very popular, of course, is Black-Scholes setting, where you have Brownian motion with drift. So basically, you use a normal distribution. And here I will want to advocate for more general distributions, namely so-called normal variance mixture distributions, which I will define later on. Okay, so given that random sum, you can, when you have first moments, you can of course calculate the expectation. Let me do that for you. So you do that by conditioning on the number of terms. And when you know the number of terms, then due to the IID assumption, you get just n times the expectation of an individual term. And then you just have to take the expectation of the number of terms, and you see the expectation is just the product of the expectations. In a similar way, when you have second moments, you can calculate the variance of the random sum. And there's a general formula for doing it. So you get the expectation of the conditional variance. That's easy to calculate. So once you know the number of terms, you use that you have independent IID terms. So you get n times the variance of the individual claims. That's easy to take the expectation. You get this term. And the variance of the conditional expectation, well, that one we calculated up there. So basically, you get the variance of the number of terms times the first moment of the individual claims squared. So notice, in general, the variance is larger than the expected number of terms times the variance. you get an additional term due to the variation of the number of terms, but the term goes away if these random variables are centered. So what else can you do? Well, with modern computers, you can easily calculate the distribution of the random sum in a discrete setting. And the discrete setting is not really a problem because in practice, all claims are multiples of one unit of currency. And you can even do it in a d-dimensional grid where all the coordinates are natural numbers. And there's a fast algorithm to do it, the so-called extended Penger recursion, to compute the distribution of the random sum. But for that, you need a condition on the distribution of the number of claims. Namely, the distribution needs to be in a Penger class. To remind you, a Penger class, a distribution Qn is in a Penger class given by two real parameters, A, B, and a natural number K, if the first K terms are zero, and after that, you have that recursion formula between these probabilities describing the distribution of the number of terms. And all these distributions were determined. Here you have the names and the years. I will come back to the last reference in a few minutes. So which distributions are there? Well, there are some basic Penger class distributions. Most of them are familiar to you, I assume. So the Poisson distribution is a very easy case, and I will use that one a lot during this talk. The binomial distribution, the negative binomial distribution, which actually is a compound Poisson distribution, where you make the parameter lambda here random, giving it a gamma distribution. That's a classic calculation. The logarithmic distribution, here to remind you how it looks like. So basically it decays like with a power of p divided by n, so you get the series here by developing that term. And in the process of the characterization of all these Penger class distributions, two additional distribution families came up, namely the extended logarithmic distribution, given by these terms. I will not need it in the future. And the extended negative binomial distribution. And here it really is some work to verify that you get a probability distribution. So the normal negative binomial distribution, you have these terms here with a positive alpha, but here the alpha is allowed to be negative. So you really have to check it gives a probability distribution. And here's a theorem I already mentioned on a slide before by three colleagues from the Technical University in Dresden, Germany. And they proved that a non-degenerate distribution is in a Penger class if it is either one of the distributions I just gave you, or it's a K-truncation of one of these basic distributions. And the truncation means that you look at the conditional distribution. So you require that a certain number of terms actually happens. And here's a formal way how you calculate the K-truncation. Of course, you have to assume that there's actually some mass at K or above K. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Okay, and here's that extended Penger recursion I already mentioned. So it was introduced by Harry Penger into actuarial science, and since then it's taught to the students. Then Sund has generalized it to higher dimensions, and Hess, Liewold, and Schmidt in their paper also extended it to these more general Penger class distributions. So assume you have a probability distribution for the number of claims, and it belongs to such a Penger class, and here's a technical condition which doesn't really hurt you. And you have these IID claims taking values in the grid of with coordinates given by natural numbers, then you can calculate the distribution of the random sum, where the number of terms is now random, given according to that distribution, in the following way. Namely, there's a starting value at the for the origin. You evaluate the probability-generating function of the number of terms at the probability of a zero claim. And then you use that recursion formula. So here, that's just a factor which is well-defined due to the conditional, due to the condition on the parameter A. Then the next term here vanishes for k equal to zero, unless, for k equal to one, it's just the distribution of the first claim. And afterwards, you have to calculate it using convolution, because then it's a distribution of the sum of the first k claims. And here comes the recursion. So when you have in a two-dimensional case, and one and two, the two coordinates of the n you are using here, then you have to sum over all the grid points. Well, I'm not going to draw them all. Well, now they are all okay. So you have to sum over all the grid points, excluding the origin, because you have a recursion formula. And in for every term, you have the previously calculated probabilities, and here you need the distribution of the claim size. And here that's determined by the recursion formula given by the Penja class. And here the Cn shows up. That's necessary due to the higher dimensional setting. So the Cn has to be chosen such that you do not divide by zero here. So given an n which is not the origin, there's at least one coordinate which is different from zero, and then you can take the corresponding unit vector in that direction. So that does it. You can take other choices. It just has to be different from zero. Okay, here's a short historical comment on the recursion. You can trace it back already to Euler, so that's 270 years. Namely, when you look at the power series, where the constant term is not equal to zero, then you can look at the alpha's power of the reciprocal. It's also a power series. Let's name the coefficients bn. And these bn can be calculated recursively. And for certain distributions, that recursion is equivalent to the Penja recursion. And it was rediscovered several times, as you can find out by reading the paper by Gold. Well, maybe you know it now, you don't need to rediscover it. Okay, so you can also be worried about numerical stability of the recursion. When you look at these parameters A and B, so when that sum stays non-negative for all possible values of the J, then you never have cancellation. You never calculate a difference of two positive numbers, which can be dangerous. And that condition is certainly satisfied when the A is non-negative and the B is larger than minus A. So here for these three distributions and their truncations, there's not a problem. For the three here, you can have problems. Well, the binomial one is not so important in applications. And for these two, I have an older paper which explains how you can get around it, around the cancellation problem by just investing more computer time. Okay, so here, let me give another example. Namely, I listed for you all the distributions where you can apply the algorithm. But there are more distributions where you can apply the algorithm. You just have to do it in a more clever way. Maybe apply it two times. And here's an example where you have to apply the algorithm two times. So the so-called Poisson-tempered alpha-stable mixtures. So you start with an index alpha between 0 and 1. So that's the alpha from these stable distributions you might be familiar with. And a scale parameter, and you consider a random variable which is alpha stable and distributed on the non-negative half-life. So that distribution is uniquely determined by the Laplace transform. So at point S, the Laplace transform is the exponential of minus some constant, which is explicitly given over there, times the alpha's power of S. So and these distributions are very heavy-tailed, so that they might not be so useful, but you can temper them. So you have a tempering parameter tau, non-negative, and you just give a small weight to the large values of the random variable. Of course, you have to normalize in order to keep a probability distribution. So that's a three-parameter class of distributions on the positive half-life. And by using tau strictly positive, you have expectations. And now assume you have such a random variable with, which has a tau-tempered alpha-stable distribution with scale parameter sigma, and you look at a counting variable, so the number of claims, such that the conditional distribution, given you know that lambda, is a Poisson distribution. So it's called a Poisson mixture distribution, mixed by a tau-tempered alpha-stable one. And I, for convenience, I add a scaling parameter lambda for later purposes. So such a counting random variable, you can represent in another way. That's an older theorem with a colleague of mine and a former PhD student. Namely, the distribution of that n here is the same as a random number of claim numbers. So the number of them is Poisson distributed. Here you see the Poisson parameter, which you can work out. And every individual n is distributed according to an extended negative binomial distribution with these parameters. So you really have to do the algebra to see that. It took us some time to discover it. So you can represent the distribution of n as a compound Poisson random variable. So that means when you now want to calculate the distribution of a random sum, where the number of terms here is given in the way described on the last slide, you can actually calculate the distribution by putting together some claims, calculate the sum here, and then summing again. So when you introduce new random variables with IID with the same distributions, you see it more clearly. Namely, here you apply the Penger algorithm for the extended negative binomial distribution, and then you apply it again for the Poisson distribution. And the extended negative binomial distribution is not numerically stable, so you can work around this. You find it in the paper. The algorithm is here, but I don't want to concentrate on this today. Also, if the tau is zero, there's a special algorithm to do it, so it's still numerically stable. But I will come back to these distributions later on to have another example. Okay, here are two specific examples of these tau-tempered alpha-stable distributions. Normally, you don't have densities for them, but the special case alpha equal to 1/2, you do have densities. Namely, if you have index 1/2, scale parameter sigma, and no tempering, then you get the so-called Levy distribution. Here you find the density. And that's actually the distribution of the first hitting time of Brownian motion reaching a level, and you can work it out. The level should be the square root of the parameter. I hope that's now correct. Similarly, you can get the inverse Gaussian distribution with parameters mu and sigma. So you define yourself new parameters. So the tempering parameter you have to choose is this one, and the scale parameter you have to choose this one, and then you get a density of the tau tempered 1/2 stable distribution with scale sigma to look like this one, so the inverse Gaussian distribution, and you get that one by again having a Brownian motion, but with a drift this time. The drift is given here. It's 1 divided by tilde sigma, hitting the level given by the quotient of these parameters. So these naturally turn up these distributions. Okay, skip these. If you want to learn more in this direction, you can go to my homepage. So I have some lecture notes on credit risk modeling where this is included. The paper I cited previously, and a former PhD student of mine, Cordelia Rudolph, she has worked in that area and came up with additional distributions where you can apply variants of Penger's recursion. Now let me go on and explain to you some prerequisites for the approximation theorem I want to present today. So consider two real-valued random variables. I will stick to the actuarial interpretation that losses are positive because actuaries care about risk. So losses are positive here. Then you can define lower quantiles. I don't have to repeat that here for you. And you can define the Kolmogorov distance between two distributions. So the distance index Kolmogorov between the distributions, it's the supremum of the distribution functions of these two random variables, x and y. So it's a supremum norm of the distribution functions. And that Kolmogorov distance, you can verify it's really a metric because it's a metric. The supremum norm is a metric, and when it's zero, they are actually the same, so it's really a metric. So that's why I call it metric up there. And you can, with a metric, control the quantiles, which are also named value at risk and risk management. So assume X is a model you have, where you can calculate everything in a precise manner. And why is, well, the real thing you are not so sure about. But you believe that you are quite close to reality, so the Kolmogorov distance is bounded above by D, let's say. You believe your model is quite good. Then you can have upper and lower estimates for the quantile, so for value at risk, for the real think by using your model distribution, and you have to adjust the level according to the Kolmogorov distance. So the Kolmogorov distance helps you to get upper and lower quantiles, so upper and lower bounds for value at risk. I hope that's the motivation to look at that abstract distance between probability measures. Same thing similar for expected shortfall as a risk measure. Here I hardly have to repeat the definition of expected shortfall. You find it up there. The important thing is you have the quantile, and when you have the identity, you just make it constant below the quantile, so in particular here, so you have x, and here you have h of x, let's say, and the function h of x is Lipschitz continuous with Lipschitz constant 1. That we will use that in a moment. And you take the average here above the quantile, and the mass above the quantile is 1 minus the level. That's why we have 1 minus the level there. So in the metric I want to use here, or the distance I want to use, is the Wasserstein distance defined up here. So in general, you can do it with a metric space, but let's stick to the real numbers or Rn. So you have two random variables, and you want to define the Wasserstein distance, the one Wasserstein distance between the distributions, and you do it in the following way. Namely, you take a bounded function, real-valued function, which has a Lipschitz constant at most 1. And you calculate the difference between the two expectations of h of x and h of y, the other one. Since the function h is bounded, there is no problem with the existence of the expectations. So that inner supremum here is no problem. Now, when you increase the bound, you have more and more functions, so the supremum can go up. It might be plus infinity, so that's why I don't speak about Wasserstein metric, because the metric is not allowed to take the value plus infinity, but I call it a distance. If you want to turn it into a metric, just add some concave function to it, which is bounded above, and you get a metric. If we are in the vector-valued case here, and x and y have an expectation, then of course these expectations of h composed with x and h composed with y also have expectations, and you don't need the bound. But in general, you need the bound. In particular, because later on I want to calculate distances of distributions which do not have an expectation. So that's why I'm careful here. And the Wasserstein distance helps you to get bounds on expected shortfall, differences of expected shortfall, due to the fact that such an h is Lipschitz with constant 1, you can derive this bound. So it's the difference of expected shortfalls bounded above by the Wasserstein distance of the two distributions divided by 1 minus the delta, because we only look at that part, and there that factor comes up. Okay, so now I want to give you a justification for these Poisson mixture distributions. So I have two slides on that. So assume you have Bernoulli random variables x1 up to xn, and you have, let's say, a macroeconomic variable, which we call capital lambda. Let's assume it's bounded in such a way that the largest one of these parameters, these probabilities, times the lambda never exceeds 1. Just stick to that for a moment. So you want the lambda to model the macroeconomic variable. And let's think of xi being a default indicator. Then we assume that given you know the state of the economy, you know the conditional probability of a default, namely it's the parameter pi times the lambda. So a large lambda might stand for an economic crisis, so default probabilities go up. And a low lambda can stand for a boom cycle. Every company survives, and or nearly every company survives, and all these probabilities are very low. And assume these default indicators to be independent given the macroeconomic state variable, the lambda. So that's spelled out here. So then we call the collection of these random variables and the macroeconomic variable a one-factor Bernoulli mixture model. And you can easily calculate default probabilities here by just conditioning on the lambda. And in case the lambda has expectation one, this Pi can be seen as default probabilities. So now let's look at this Bernoulli mixture model from the previous slide. Let's look at the sum of defaults and the sum of the probabilities and introduce an additional random variable, capital N, which, given the macroeconomic variable, is assumed to be Poisson distributed. And then we want to look at the total variation distance between the sum of the indicators, so the sum of defaults in the portfolio, and our Poisson mixture random variable. So we take the total variation distance, so that's defined as the supremum over all subsets of the natural numbers, including zero, of the expectation that the W takes the value in A minus the expectation that the approximation N takes the value in A. And you can generalize from indicator functions to functions taking values in the unit interval. And then you can also insert a conditional expectation, condition on the lambda that doesn't change a thing. But the term here, the conditional expectation, written down here again, now it's easy to handle. Namely, the conditional distribution of the W given the lambda is just the sum of independent Bernoullis. And the N given the lambda is just Poisson. So you have the Poisson approximation theorem available. That's a classical estimate by Barber and Hall. Namely, of course, you can first estimate by the total variation distance of the conditional distributions. And for these, you apply that classical estimate, and that's what you get, this magical factor coming out from the Stein-Chen method, times the sum over the squares of the default probabilities. Now you plug in that estimate up there, and there's one lambda which cancels. So what you get for the total variation distance is the expectation of this one. And here you get the sum of the squares of the PIs. And you have a decay by the lambda. So that's why I had the lambda there separately. And here that's just some number you can calculate. If capital lambda has expectation one, this is certainly bounded by one. So fine. You can have a similar estimate for the Wasserstein distance, no big deal. Okay, so that justifies how Poisson mixture distributions can come up as sum of Bernoullis which are dependent due to one macroeconomic variable. Okay, as last preparation for the limit theorem, let me introduce normal variance mixture distributions. So in the general R-devalued case, a vector has such a distribution if you find this given location vector and given dispersion matrix, if you find a dimension, a matrix A with appropriate size, such that A times A transpose gives you the dispersion matrix. And you can always have in K dimension a standard, normally distributed random variable or random vector, which I call x throughout the talk. And you have a variance mixture variable lambda, not non-negative. And on purpose, I called it lambda. The same name as in the Poisson mixture distributions, on purpose. And I assume it's independent of the normally distributed random variable. And then the Z has such a normal variance mixture distribution if in distribution it's equal to that expression, so the location, then the linear transform of the standard normal blown up or shrinked by the square root of the lambda. Because I call it a variance mixture, I have to take the square root because the variance you get when you square. So here are some examples. So of course, the constant case just gives you a normal distribution. When you take the lambda to be gamma distributed, you get the normal variance gamma mixture distribution. So it has a special gamma in the name. The special case alpha equal to 1 corresponds to the exponential distribution and gives you the Laplace distribution in d dimensions with center mu. You can look at the lambda where the inverse of it has a gamma distribution. Of course, why not? If the two parameters are the same, let's say 2 times nu, then you actually get a t distribution with nu degrees of freedom. If nu equals 1, you get a d-dimensional Cauchy distribution. And of course, as lambda, you can also take these tau-tempered alpha-stable distributions. There, the corresponding normal variance mixture distributions don't seem to have a special name. Sorry for that. Okay, so the limit theorem, I still have a few minutes. So the setting is the following, namely, we take a sequence of independent random variables. They don't need to be identically distributed. I just assume they are all centered for convenience and have a variance 1 that makes life easier. And estimates will be in terms of absolute third moments, so it's better to assume they are finite, otherwise the bounds are meaningless. So we take a random variable. We want to exclude an atom at the origin, so I assume they are strictly positive. The lambda is strictly positive. I assume I have, for every small lambda, a counting random variable which conditioned on the lambda is Poisson with this parameter. So at n lambda is a Poisson mixture. So maybe I take note of that one. Poisson lambda, capital lambda. And then I look at these scaled Poisson mixture sums. So capital Z index lambda is equal to 1 divided by the square root of small lambda. So lambda is, in case I calculate here, the expectation shows up as a factor. That's why I take the square root of it. And the sum n from 1 up to that counting variable, the xn. And I can do that for every lambda, strictly positive. And the limiting random variable I want to consider, the z, I define as the square root of capital lambda times x with x standard normally distributed. And of course, appropriate independence. And I don't want to assume that third moments are bounded. Of course, you can do so. But what we treated is a weighted average, a Poisson weighted average of absolute third moments. That enables us to also look at increasing third moments and still have an approximation theorem. And you can rewrite this in a more stochastic way. So if P lambda is a Poisson distribution, it's per lambda lambda. So you sum the first terms given by that Poisson distribution, take the expectation, and divide by the expected number of terms. So that's that term. Okay, and here's the main theorem for the Wasserstein distance. So take that random variable here and divide by the square root of capital lambda. Then on the set where the third moments give you any help, you can have that the expectation here is almost surely finite. And the Wasserstein distance between that the distribution of the random variable here conditioned and the standard normal distribution is finite. And you have that estimate here. The Wasserstein distance between this normalized or scaled random sum conditioned on the lambda, the distance to a standard normal is given by that quantity here involving a constant and involving the third moments, which is if they are bounded, you can plug in the bound here. And it goes to zero when you send lambda to infinity by the square root of lambda. As a consequence, if the expectation of that term is finite, which is certainly satisfied with bounded third moments, then you have an estimate of the Wasserstein distance between the normal variance mixture distribution, which doesn't need to have finite expectation, and that random sum given by that quantity. So here, bounded third moments give you a constant here, and so it goes to zero with square root of the intensity lambda which you put in there. And since it's so easy to derive 5 from 4, let me do that. It's on one slide here. Namely, what you have to do is look at the Wasserstein distance between the two distributions, and you do that by taking a bounded function which is Lipschitz continuous. Okay, then you can insert a conditional expectation here, it doesn't do any harm. And the conditional distributions you have under control by estimate 4. So you first go to the Wasserstein distance between the two distributions. Then you plug in the definitions here and here. And you use the scaling property of the Wasserstein distance. Namely, you can take the square root of n out with equality. And for that term, the approximation by the standard normal random variable, you have the result from 4. So you get 5 for free in case of the Wasserstein distance once you have 4. And for 4, to get that one, you apply Stein's method, but I don't have time to explain Stein's method to you. I'm sorry, but I will happily do so at the end. And so that's in one distance, in the Wasserstein distance. You can also do it in the Kolmogorov distance. You find that in his thesis. Here, things get more complicated. You don't have that scaling property. You have to work harder. Also, the test functions you have are not continuous, in particular, not Lipschitz continuous anymore. As test functions, you have indicator functions on half lines. So they jump. That makes life more difficult. So what you get is an estimate given here with these constants. So I don't claim they are optimal, but these are constants we got. And the control here is one additional term up there, which annoyed me, but somehow stick there. Okay, I think my time is up, so I stop here and available for questions after the second talk.
Exactly. Thank you.